Hi, welcome to this presentation on getting more out of your Plexus 2D and your Plexus 3D applications. My name is Michel van der Sloot and I work for Bentley Systems. And today I'll be talking about workflow tips. So to get more out of your Plexus 2D or your Plexus 3D application and to have better geotechnical analysis, we will discuss three topics here today. First one will be about more efficient Plexus usage and to help you speed up your application usage and to spend less time in repetitive tasks. Second will be about getting forces from structural elements. And finally, we'll be talking about how to import data into Plexus. More efficient Plexus usage. Whenever you start the Plexus application, you will see that there's a command line available. And this command line is actually very important in the Plexus application. Actually, everything that you do, any model change, will go through the command line. So even if you use your mouse and you click on your screen to, for instance, draw a point or a line, you will see that the command is generated. So all the user interface tools will transfer into a command. So this is the entry point of doing everything in your application. And the command line can do everything that the user interface can do, and even more. There are some special commands that are not exposed in the user interface, but are only available through a command. So if you want to know to learn anything about the commands, you can find them in the help commands reference. There's a detailed description of what it does and what's the command syntax, so that will help you to do that. We took effort making sure that this syntax is very simple to understand. So it's a low overhead syntax. For instance, if you want to create a point, just type in point, space, x coordinate, space, y coordinate, hit enter, and that's it. Not working with brackets, that's not necessary. That's the whole design of the command line here. And once we know how to use the command line, we can also use more advanced tools and store command lists, maybe use the commands roadmap and macros. To understand the command line, there are some visual features that help you to use that. If the syntax highlighting, so it will give you different colors for different types of items. For instance, commands will be dark blue, and strings, so text representations, and numbers will have a different color. Also, if there's something you defined is not correct, Plexus will give you an indication with red text. If you want to use more advantage, if you want to reuse items from the command line, you can reuse existing commands, so no need to copy paste. Just use a keyboard, use the up and down arrow on the keyboard to reuse, to revisit previous commands. And there's also a command autocomplete with the latest release. This has just been released in the Plexus 2D and 3D Connect Edition version 20 update 3. So this is now also available in Git, and you can just you can just have Plexus give suggestions for how to use the command line. So it will definitely help to speed up this behavior. Now, if we understand the command line, then we can also make use of the command runner. The command runner you can typically use when you have more than one command. It's available in the expert menu. And here we can type multiple commands before executing them into the Plexus application. We can also, of course, store command list and load them. Or you might want to prepare something in a spreadsheet program or in your own personal text file editor. And then you can just copy and paste everything here in the commands runner and execute them using the run everything button. And sometimes you have these command lists that you use more frequently. And if you have that, you want to reuse those command lists quite often. Fortunately, Plexus also has a macro functionality, and in this macro functionality, you can add your own list of commands as a macro. So this is available in the expert menu, and you can just create a few of those macros and access them from here. Also, there are some keyboard shortcuts available that incorporate using the Shift, Control, and Alt key together with the number of the macro, so that will be ranging from 1 to 9. Once we use macros, having additional functionality are quite useful. One of these extra features for the command line is the array indexing indexing syntax. Plexus stores all similar objects in containers or lists. That can be points, lines, plates, faces, groups, interfaces, you know it, you name it. Everything which has the same type of grouping possible, you can use that. Now, listables, these are the items which are in the in this list. These you can get them using the square bracket notation, and then within the square brackets you give the so-called index. So that will be the position of that element within that list. For instance, if you want to get the first point that you created in the model, you can type in points square bracket 0. So yes, the first item is 0. This indexing is 0 based. So if you type in points square brackets 0, it will be the first. If you type in points square brackets 1, it will actually be the second one. Now you also see here in the examples there's a negative index. This negative index indicates that we will count starting from the end of the list. So for instance, if you want to get the latest created line, we can use lines square brackets minus 1, and that will give you the last created line. So that these special features can help you to have more control in your macros. For instance, if you create a line and you want to create positive and negative interfaces to the last created line, we can use lines minus 1 to do that. So let's show this in a small demonstration. So let's do our demonstration here. I'll start with an empty model. So if I click here on the point, I can create point, and you can see if I click here at the bottom, we created a point. Of course, a bit difficult to see at the bottom, so I'm going to use the pop-out functionality. So set them here side to side so we can see what's going on. So what I can also do that I can type the point name. This here, also point, and you can see with the command line autocomplete, it will automatically give me some suggestions that I can use. You can activate this in the options menu, autocomplete. You have the geotechnical select entitlements available, of course, to use this. So let's enable autocomplete here. So actually here, you can select point, and then I can say 1, 2, and create a new point here, which of course is not the correct location. So I just type undo. That is suggested to me. Maybe I want to type in point, and I just do an additional command, point 1, 2, 3. And you can see that this says gives me invalid parameters. So make sure that the specified parameters match the one that are expected. So you can see that the Plexus corner will give you all these kind of directions here to help you understand the how well this can be used. And maybe I want to add a point load to the last created point. So set before points minus 1, and see it here. Then I apply a point load on points minus 1. And you can see here, it's added here in my geometry. So that's good. Now to go to a bit more advanced solution, I will load here a model that already has defined a few construction stages. So here we have the model. It's a embankment construction Causing several phases. Maybe you want to define a few of the options that we want to do using the command line. So it can be a phase dot phase 1 dot max course, and I want to set the maximum course that I want to use, maybe to 2, and maybe also phase 1 I want to change the deform calculation type. I want to set it to, in this case, let's set it to plastic, just for the exercise. And you can see here that the phase 1 construction stage actually here now changed to plastic. But then I just want to set it back to consolidation. Now we can do that. Now, of course, sometimes you just want to apply all the phases or something, so we can use the apply command, and apply this on all the commands using the set properties tool. Then I want to make a change to max course
to 4 to speed up my calculation, and I also want to get the parameter max steps stored, so the number of steps that will be stored while I run the calculation, so I can use that as the post-processing. Then I may add 15. And then we change all the phases all at once. Maybe I want to go to phase 4 here. Check it. 4, it should show me the max cost use 4, maximum number of steps stored 15. So with this one, it's also easy to create these kind of things. Of course, maybe I want to go to use it using the run command or the macro library. So let's go to the manage micro library. Create a new one. Maybe it's just a shift course to 4. No, we already changed that, so let's do 3. So then I can do so I can do apply phases set properties max course to 3. That's okay. And now I can go from the exponent macro and then set course to 3. Really done really quickly. You can see you can quickly change the number of course for all my construction stages to 3. That's also a very easy way to use automation. Final part might be that you have prepared point loads, for instance. Maybe we have these different point loads and different values here, which are all located in Microsoft Excel. So let's load. So here in Excel, we have a load table. So it's the X and Y coordinate of the point load and its value in downward direction. And we can then specify the command needed for that one. Point load. Of course, we need to specify the x coordinate and the y coordinate, but we can also set the directly in the same command. We have y value, and you have to realize that the command, which is in downward direction, should be a negative y value. We can just make this all. Copy it, so we use the same formulation, and now we can just copy all the cells here and then go to the Plexus program. Here we are, we go to the expert run, paste this thing. You can see it's nicely formatted, nicely aligned. Now we'll put it here on the side so we can see what's going to happen. So then if I press F8, I will run that commands one by one. If I do run everything, just run everything, it's F9, run first line, F8, again I can step 2 so you can see what's going on. We can do F8, 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 F8. And you can see that I apparently switched the X and Y coordinate. You can see the values are just all over the place, which of course should not be the case. So I'll just do undo. Now I'll do that 20 times, I've removed back to my Excel. Apparently I made a mistake because here I took not the Y coordinate, but I took the force value. So let's correct it all. So now that that is fixed, I can then just only copy the commands, Control C. Then I go to the Plexus program. Here I go to the. I paste everything here. And see, I have the point load command with X and Y coordinates. Downward force value also included directly here. Then I put it on the side. Use F8. Quickly add these from my spreadsheet program. And you can see the values are all added here. First point here at 0.4 with a minus 25 kN value from my Plexus 2D plane strain model. These are a few easy ways to help you with automation. The command line with autocomplete, the commands runner, and the micro library that can help you speed up your calculation in relatively easy ways.
So after this demonstration, the commands running and the macros, they're great for repetitive commands. And also it's very easy to link it with text files and spreadsheets that you fill with commands. But of course, there are also limitations. As you've seen, there's not much interaction with data, and the results there are only available in the command line session. We cannot reuse those results or values that are in the application to have, for instance, conditional statements as an if or case or while kind of statements. That's not possible. And we can also not directly export to files or spreadsheets from this command line. So what would we be able to do next? If we go beyond the command line, we can use the remote scripting interface with a nice Python wrapper. So when using Python, we can do all kinds of stuff in the application. You can think about creating materials, as you're seeing here. Or maybe you want to manipulate phases. In this case, you will see that after every consolidation stage, a safety analysis has been created. Or you want to maybe get the results out of Plexus in an automatic fashion. Maybe create specific curves. Maybe you want to compute the results in the output program, or do some kind of integration to get the total earth pressure on the retaining wall, for instance. So that's all possible using the scripting interface. Then, of course, we have seen now different levels of automation, and both have their pros and cons. So what are the positive items when you do not use scripting? Now, when we do not use scripting, we can do almost anything that Plexus can do. It's easy to learn, just use your mouse, and you can click on the user interface in the geometry. So that's quite easy to do. Just click a button and select the thing that you want to do. So it's very visual. The downside, of course, is if you have to do something over and over and over again, this can be boring and time consuming. And when you have to do it quite often, the chance of making a small mistake is increasing also with that. So that's also not good if you will have to do these repetitive tasks quite often. Now, with the command line, we can do anything that the Plexus software can do. As I said before, anything that you change in the model has to go through the command line. So the command line will be the central point, and that means that anything that you can do with the command line, the software can do this. It has a low learning curve, especially now with the autocomplete features. And then the benefit also that if you have external data prepared as commands, then you can use the spreadsheets and use the commands runner and macros for more automation. Downside is that the script cannot go outside the project context, and it cannot make runtime decisions. Anything that you do has a predefined value. Now, if we go one step further, using remote scripting or a Python interface, this really goes beyond any Plexus functionality that you can think of. And it can have any automated action and decisions at runtime based on, of course, criteria that you set in your scripting. Of course, it means that you have to learn how to use it. So it has some investment in your time and effort. And because of this, it's also not worth for simple and straightforward projects, because you have to test your script if it works. So if your project is not that complicated, or you just want to do a quick run, probably it's better to go without scripting, maybe combine it with a little bit of the command line by typing it. But if you do more complex repetitive items, I would say have a look at the automation tools. Second topic here, getting forces from structural elements. Now, if you look at forces in your structural elements, if you think about the retaining wall, we can think about two types of wall definitions based on the geometry. It can be a thin wall or a thick wall. Now, the thin wall is shown here on the top using the blue plate elements. And you can do this using plate elements when the wall thickness is much smaller than the wall length, say like a ratio of 1 over 10 or more. So 1 over 10, 1 over 15, 1 over 20. You're not interested in end bearing, mostly friction. Then you can use plate elements, and a direct output of this is structural forces. So normal force, bending moment, shear force, you can read them directly in the output program. If you look at the bottom solution, we say that this is a thick wall. In this case, wall thickness is significant. And also, end bearing capacity is in this case needed, especially when you have such a thick wall that the wall thickness is significant. Usually it also involves end bearing capacity. In such cases, it's better to use a thick wall. And with such a thick wall, basically we define soil elements. We just draw a rectangle and we assign a soil material to it. Of course, it will not be truly soil material. It will be a material that represents the behavior of the structural element. For instance, in this case, concrete. And if you do not expect that we will have cracking or creep kind of behavior for the concrete, then we can just use a linear elastic material, or we can use the concrete material and to specify this one. The downside of this material, because we just use these so-called soil elements or volume elements, and with these volume elements we just have stresses, we do not have forces as a direct output. So we can use two tricks for that. We can use a plate with fixtures properties, or we can use structural forces from volumes. This is a tool in the output program. So let's have a look at the first option, the fixtures or dummy plate. In this case, the soil elements or the volume elements are defined using a material data set that represents the wall material. So that's the green material that we see here in the image. Since it's difficult to obtain structural force from soil elements, we can introduce a plate in the middle. It's shown here in the dashed blue line. But you have to make sure that this dummy plate will not influence the deformations. In that case, we can set a low stiffness. And also, since the volume elements already have a weight defined, we should also not define a weight for the plate material. It should be located in a neutral line, because we're going to, as you will see, we're going to base it on strain and curvature of the neutral line. So usually this means you define it in the middle. And since we assume tight bonding to the concrete elements, we will have no interfaces defined around the plate element. Of course, around the structural element, we will define interfaces. So around the green rectangle, we will still define interfaces for soil structure interaction, if you want to model it like that. But along the plate, we will not define interfaces. Now, there are some assumptions with this technique, and that's something that you have to keep in mind. Tight bonding of dummy plate with the volume plate, and since we assume that, then we can say that the strain of the soil element is equal to the strain of the dummy plate. And the same for the curvature, kappa. So the curvature of the soil element will be equal to the curvature of the dummy plate. Once again, presence of the dummy plate should not change the result. So you should have a very low stiffness for the dummy plate. So how does this work? Now let's take here in this example bending, which is a typical case for retaining walls. So the soil elements will have a stiffness, let's call it E real. We have also flexural rigidity, or the bending stiffness, it's the I real, which will be 1 over 12 times d to the power 3, and with d the wall thickness. And this is of course assuming using plane strain elements and taking 1 meter out of plane. Now from our mechanics class, we will know that bending will be dependent on curvature. And the formula is M, bending moment M, is equal to EI times kappa. And of course we can then rearrange it such that kappa is m over ea. So then we can, of course, then relate the real curvature. So that's the curvature of the green volume element and the curvature of the dummy plate, since we assume that this will have tight bonding, so we will take them equal. That means that the that we can have the real bending stiffness over the real EI, so the bending stiffness. That should be equal to the bending moment of the dummy plate over the bending stiffness EI. So that should be equal. So that ratio should be equal when we assume that this curvature will be the same. So if we take EI sufficiently small, let's say it's a factor 1 mm smaller than the real one, that means that our bending moment of the dummy plate, at taking into account that we use the same, that we get the same curvature, that will be also a factor of the real bending moment. So that will be also the bending moment m over x, and with x is this factor. So with that, we can also relate the results that we get in the output program, and we will define them by multiplying them back using this factor. So then you can sort of nearly directly read the results in the output program using this trick. We can do the same for axial forces. And this is based on strains, the axial force, and of course the stiffness and surface area of the cross section of the element. So then we can apply the same trick here, taking into account this same factor. So this trick, using this fixtures plate, it relies on strain and curvature inside the defined volume for the structural element. One thing to note here is that, of course, the when we make a wish in place change of soil material to the structural material, actually we're already starting, of course, with a initial weight of the soil. So this is the initial vertical stress already in the soil elements. When we switch to the structural material dataset, and at that time we will also switch on the dummy plate, but of course this initial stress is not there, is not present there. So that's something to take into account when getting the dummy plate solution, what the initial configuration is. Second solution, if we know from our mechanics class, is that if you have stresses, you can integrate them and get forces. So for instance, if you have a uniform distribution of a normal stress on a cross section, so that's shown here, we can integrate that and actually we get the actual force. The same for a true bending moment, or if you have the one on the right hand side, this is the also the integration and gives you a normal force and a bending moment. So taking this into account, since we define the structural element using volume elements, we can also do that and use this to integrate stresses in any cross section and then define the get the forces out. So this also has been introduced in our Plexus program. It's available in the post-processing program Plexus 2D output. How to use this is that you select a region or material. Plexus will automatically determine the center line of this, as you can see here. Then it will, based on the element configuration, will define these cross sections. This is all done automatically. You do not have to do this. You just have to select the material. Plexus will define which is the longest direction, determines the center line, and then determines the cross sections. And then for each cross section, it will determine the normal stress. And when we have the normal stress, we can of course compute the axial force and bending moment, or if you integrate the shear stress, then it can give you the shear force. So here we have the normal stress, and then of course we can define, so the average normal stress on such a cross section will determine our axial force. And then we can of course integrate this for each and every cross section, and then we can plot a axial force diagram for the height of the retaining wall. So this trick relies on the integrated stresses in the elements, unlike the other tool, which relies on strains and curvature. So let's do a demo case and also compare the results of these two retaining walls defined with volume elements. Here on the left, we see the solution using the dummy plate solution, and on the right hand side we'll see the one where we use the integrated stressor solution, so the structural forces from volumes.
So here we have our model. It's a simple excavation project. The initial phase, we install the walls. We have first excavation, second excavation. You can see we define the diaphragm wall here on the left and right hand side using these volume elements in blue. Here both have interfaces all around, and you can see here we use the dummy plate solution. So I will use both solutions here. It's a symmetrical loading case, so we can compare what the results give us. So how does it look? If we look at here the material here, it's a concrete material, linear elastic with a certain weight. Parameters of concrete telling the stiffness and Poisson's ratio. And then when we look at the dummy plate element, I have to apply, of course, the factor of the I already mentioned in the presentation of the 1 million, so I divided the EI by 1 million, also the EI with 1 million, and give us these parameters, and the equivalent thickness, which is a control parameter, gives us here 1 meter. So that makes sense. That is, looks to be okay. Then, of course, I can run the calculation and see the results. So here is my deformation plot. We can see our deformations here. I've just double clicked the plate. I can also see the deformations, but it's really cool. I directly can go to the bending moment. But you see here at the bottom, of course, very low values. It's the maximum value is 1 times 10 to the power minus 21, and the minimum value is 0.34 times 10 to the power minus 3. But of course, we have to apply this factor, so we have to apply the factor of 1 million. So actually, we would have about roughly 347 cubic meter per meter in terms of bending moment for this final phase. Now, we can also look at these results for this part. What we will then do is this tool here is the structural forces volume plates. And I know that this is material concrete 2. Concrete 2, I will detect. And automatically it will determine this one. And you can see here I have bending moment of 357 cubic meter per meter. Also, you can see nicely the element and cross-section distribution, what has been used to determine this. That also gives you a good indication of how dense the results are determined. Now if we put these values side by side, so here they are tied side by side, zoom in a little bit. So here it will give me a value of 347 cubic meter, and this side 357. So this is a very comparable result. You will see if you refine the mesh a bit more, the results will be even more same.
Some final notes here on structural forces. The dummy plate results, they're not directly available in graph or the table because you have to apply a factor of this. So if you directly present the results to your client, he might ask, why is this factor this value for the bending moment so small, then you have to explain, of course, it's not easy to explain, but you still have to explain that that you have to apply this factor. The dummy plate needs to be added before the analysis, so you cannot at the end of the analysis, after a few hours of calculation, decide I want to get those results, because then you have to rerun the complete analysis. And also, if you have large local shear forces, these may not be accurate. And that has to do with the assumption of the plate elements themselves, which assume also a slender geometry. Now, if we look at the other solution, the stress integration or the structural force from volume solution, this is post-processing on any geometry. The internal cross-section determined based on element distribution. So the finer the mesh, the more cross-sections you will get. So that also means you will get a better force diagram. If the mesh is too coarse, then the results may become inaccurate with the coarse mesh. So results are based on internal stresses. Please be aware of construction sequence, and especially when you have wished in place type of solutions, then you have to be aware that this happened, because that can have some kind of effect on the stress distribution in your system. Our final topic, importing geometry in Plexus. There are different options for importing. We can import 2D geometry, think about DXF or DXT files. We can import 3D geometry, that will be step files, DXF, BREP, IFC. So there are different types of geometry that we can import. We also have a special tunnel geometry importer, very useful if you have tunnel constructions going on in your project, then sometimes it's better to go to the tunnel geometry and import, for instance, a TNL file. This is a Plexus generated tunnel file, or the cross section of a tunnel using DXF. And sometimes you have short investigation data like a CPT. We can also directly import this into Plexus and determine the layer configuration based on this. So if we import geometry in Plexus 2D, we have these supported formats. It will be DXF, TXT or CSV files. So these are basically text files with either tab-separated values or comma-separated values. We can import BREP files, step files, or Delft Geosystem M-series geometry files, so with the extension GEO or SDI. Some notes on this: the DWG file is no longer supported since 2D 2018. If you do have a DXF file and lines are part of polylines, these might also not be imported. The same when you have curved elements as arcs, is that the geometry will likely be partly imported. So only points, straight lines will be imported. And since Plexus 2D AE, so that's already in 2015, Plexus will not automatically create clusters when lines enclose an area. So for this, you have to create a polygon. And on our website, you can also find a solution that can automatically close these polygons for you. So how does it look in Plexus 2D if we import geometry? So this is our Plexus input mode in structures configuration. And you can see here this small icon, the green square with the arrow pointing inwards. This is the import button. And when we import, we can get this special window after we selected the file. And it will show you on the top how many points and lines and polygons we have. We can also do scaling. We can reposition the geometry, so we can have the relative offset. And at the bottom, we see the bounding box, and the bounding box will give us a good indication where the dimensions of this import is. So then we import. Now, it's always good to check how well the import is done. So we have a special option called check geometry that will give you some indication if, for instance, points or lines are positioned very closely together. And when that is the case, then Plexus will give you a warning and you can then investigate and maybe correct the geometry if needed. Plexus policy is to not change your geometry file, simply because we do not know the intent of the geometry, so we will not change it. And as a user, you have to decide which geometry you want to change. So after everything turns out to be okay, and in most of the cases it's okay, we can start assigning our soil layers, our structural elements, assign interfaces, plate elements, maybe you want to also define a tunnel. And then here we have our geometry created for the Plexus 2D analysis. Now in Plexus 3D we have the same option for importing. We can also have these different formats, so STEP or STP, BREP. We can import DXF. Note that it only supports parametric geometry, so if you have just triangulated geometry, Plexus can import up to a certain amount of internal triangles, but if it becomes too much, then the Plexus geometry cannot really handle it quite well and efficient, so then that's why it's not supported for those geometries. We can also import IFC, and point cloud from text files can also be imported, and then once you have the point cloud, you can also select how accurate the surface should be represented using the NURBS import functionality. So if we start a Plexus 3D geometry, go to structures mode, there we have the green arrow pointing down, which will be the import button, and we have two options, the import geometry and the import point cloud. So if we select the import geometry, which is the top one, then also we can get this import wizard, and it gives you the number of objects to be imported. So if it be points or surfaces, volumes, in this case it's just a single surface. We can determine its offset, so where should it be positioned, and after that we can click OK to import this. We can also import the surfaces as the top surface for our geometry when using boreholes. It's also a very nice feature because it will set the top surface of the model, which is a very good option, because then all the soil which is represented above this elevation will not be included in the model. So to do that, we go to the borehole window. There's a tab sheet called surfaces. There we can import it. Now after importing, it will give you also the same type of input wizard, so that's this one. And when it's imported and the surface is correct, it will give you this green check mark. Sometimes you have to reposition it a little bit, especially when it coincides with your boundaries. But if it doesn't really coincide nicely with your boundaries, actually you can see it here at the bottom of the screen, is that Plexus also give you a small warning, is that it cannot be used as the top-bottom surface because it's not completely touching all boundaries, and otherwise we'll have a weird definition. So it really must extend to the boundaries or beyond the boundaries. And after import, then this looks like this. So it's also an easy way to import your geometry using the import for the top surface. And especially when you know it's the top surface, then I would recommend to use that option. If you import soil layer boundaries, so the surface that represents the boundary between the first and the second soil layer, for instance, then you still have to import it as a normal surface, and then Plexus will take care of the intersection of the large soil block when you go to our to the mesh mode or the state construction mode. Now after importing, you hope of course everything will be fine. Most of the cases it is, but especially when you have very detailed geometry, that's not always the case. So we should fine-tune the geometry quality. Why? Now, of course, if we want to have a good finite element calculation, we must have a good quality mesh. And in order to have a good quality mesh, we have to start with a good quality geometry. So we have to fine-tune the geometry quality to make sure that we can run proper calculations, and also the geomechanical mechanism. So that maybe you have a geotechnical failure, or maybe you want to see how the excess pore pressure develop. We should make sure that the geometry is good enough to capture that behavior. So how can we fine tune the geometry? And of course, the best solution would be to already have good import data. But once we are inside Plexus 3D, we can fine tune by, of course, we first have to figure out where things might go wrong. And second step, of course, will be after we know if things are not correct, that we will adjust and repair the geometry. So if we are in structures mode, we can inspect the geometry after import. One thing to note here is that you do not only need to check the imported geometry, but you also have to check the quality of the geometry with already existing geometry in the model. Maybe also already have soil layers from boreholes or other structural elements. And you can think of if you import a structure which should be placed on the soil surface, but due to some inaccuracies, it's just floating above the soil surface, or it just has a small overlap. So that might also be something that you need to check if that's the case. So we have two options here. We have the tabulate commands, so we can then query the volumes and areas if they are not too small. And since the recent versions, we also have the option called check geometry. We have also a button that you have here available. And with this button, when you click it, Plexus will perform a check for all the items if they are close together. It will check points, lines, surfaces, but also the internal points of surfaces and volumes if they're not too close to other geometries. And if it's too close to other geometries, it's likely that you will have some kind of numerical or meshing problem. So that's good. Always good to check this. Now after you go to mesh mode, we also have the same options here. We can tabulate volumes and areas, which is always good to do, especially after intersection. You might end up with some small elements if the all the geometry is not properly aligned. And also we have the check geometry button available here that you can also run. Note that for very complex models, it might take some time for Plexus to check this, but it should give results within a few minutes. Also introduced in the latest versions is enhanced feedback from mesh generation when using the EMR. So we have added this EMR, enhanced mesh refinements. It also is able to detect closeness of points, elements, and those kind of things. If things are considered to be too close based on the overall size of the geometry, the mesh generation will give you more enhanced feedback. Also, it will give you indication in the geometry where you can find these kind of problems. So that's something that you have to check as well. After import, when you have to detect if the geometry has a good quality, some common issues that we see frequently in our support department. The CAT program or the CAE program might use different settings for tolerances. Plexus uses a tolerance of 10 to the power minus 6. So if items are positioned within 10 to the power minus 6 of your project unit, so mostly that will be meters when using the SI unit set. So then if it will be within 1 micrometer, Plexus will consider to be this at the same location. Your CAT program might have different tolerances. So if the tolerance for the CAT program is set to 10 to the power minus 5, then you might see some issues after importing. So that's something to note and something to check in your CAT program. Also, when you get a CAT file, this might be optimized for computer aided engineering, but maybe not for finite element modeling. So visually it might look okay, even if you zoom in, but for finite element methods, it needs to be perfect for mesh creation. Because if items are just positioned just a little bit away from each other, it might visually look okay, but actually the mesh generation might want to put some small elements in between those two volumes, which are too close together. And when that happens, you will get very low quality elements. And of course, this will not be good for your mesh generation process, nor for your calculation results. If you import multiple geometry, if you have contacting geometry, in some cases it leaves gaps or small overlaps. That can happen when you have, for instance, two connecting volumes. Maybe you have a tunnel with an inner and an outer lining. If you import those as two volumes, those things sometimes might conflict. What you can do in such cases is that you will do that you import only the surfaces that separate the volumes, and then you do not have this contacting geometry problem. In other cases, maybe you have geometry in plexus and it doesn't match your imported geometry. Maybe you have the ground anchors defined that are not connecting the retaining wall. That can of course be a problem, because then actually the ground anchor cannot be activated. Probably also will give meshing problems. So in both cases, once we detect that, we can use, for instance, the snapping options in plexus to fix the ground anchors to the rotating wall. Same for plates or beams if they do not connect to a volume. Also, if you import for instance, a diaphragm wall and you install bracing or struts, make sure that they're properly connected to the imported geometry. Also, we have a tunnel import facility. If you, for the tunnel designer, use file open, then you can open an existing plexus tunnel geometry. But most of the times, you will be looking for an import of a DXF file. Now we can do that. You have to go from the cross section to the segments, and there's a button for the import of the DXF file. Now you click on that one, you can select the file. Then you get a window, or actually in the upcoming version, it will be available by the end of the year, probably. So this is still being finalized. You'll get this window to help you tweak the geometry. So this new window will come in the version of Plexus 2D and Plexus 3D. And you can then here have a better fit of all the geometry. And then we get into this window. So this is already happening if you just import the file. Plexus will give you some tips and warnings. In this case, after importing, we have not defined anything on the properties, trajectory, or sequencing. So this is, of course, obvious that Plexus will give you this result. So after importing, we can, of course, define the properties. After the properties, you can define the trajectory, so the path of the tunnel. You can see here I've defined a geometry and with a path which is not completely straight. And as a last step, we can also, after importing, define our tunnel sequencing. So how would our tunnel progress through our model, so to simulate the tunnel advancement procedures. And after that, we can click generate. And have the tunnel generated. Next step will be that we will go to our stage construction and define the construction stages, and I'll show you how this works in a small demo.
So here our demonstration starts after the import. We have our geometry, we can have our properties defined, so we can assign materials to the different volumes here, and we also want to include plate elements, reinforcements. In this case, we only find the materials for the different volumes. We see the path here that will show on the trajectory where the tunnel axis will travel in 3D space. And here you can see different segments all defined, and also with different slicing. So that means we slice a segment in different parts, so we can use that to have our tunnel advancement procedure, so we can have our stage construction with our tunneling. That we can define here in the sequencing, so we have all the different stages will happen. Mesh generation, finally stage construction. I've hidden all the soil here, so we only see the tunnel here. You can see it's still not activated, but using the tunnel advancement features that we have, so we can just click on the tunnel and right click and select tunnel advancement. And we can do this multiple times. You can see here from top view, the side view, and the front view, what will happen when we implement all these different construction stages. Every time that you see that the tunnel is moving one step ahead, it means actually a new calculation phase in our model. This is generated quite quickly, as you can see also here from the animation. And you can see it needs a lot of construction stages before it will actually reach the end of the construction. And this is now the case.
Another option is to import field data, that is data from CPT. So we support text files. So we go to our borehole. Then we basically have to select in the field data to add the file, so we can have the green cross, use that one. And to visualize this, we have to use this double-sided arrow, and that will also show us the field data representation. Then we select the file that we want to use. So if you have in one model, you can use one CPT file to define the soil layers from. And then we can select different types of interpolations. We have Robertson, we have Kerr 3 layers. Kerr 3 layers is a Dutch standard. Robertson, of course, is an international standard, so we can use both of these options. It's defined with a minimal thickness, and then it will automatically detect the different soil layers there. You have to then manually assign the material data sets to the different soil layers, but as you can see here, you can quickly generate based on our CPT. Already define the different soil layers. So to summarize here, we have a, if you want to get more out of your Plexus 2D and your Plexus 3D analysis, you can start by looking into how to use your Plexus in a more efficient way. Command line and macros are easier to start. If you want to have more efficiency for repetitive behavior and repetitive tasks, Python scripting can be a good solution. So also have a look in that direction if you want to take more advantage of automation. Secondly, we had a look at the getting forces from structural elements, the difference between thick and thin plates, and how you can solve this getting forces from your analysis. And finally, how to get your external data into Plexus by importing data. So we've shown some workflows for Plexus 2D, strategies that you can apply in Plexus 3D, the tunnel import option, which is a bit of a hidden gem, and finally the field data import using CPT data. So I hope you find this useful today and that it will help you to get more out of your geotechnical finite element analysis using Plexus. So thank you for your time.